You're listening to the audio production of The Science of the Good Samaritan, Thinking Bigger About Loving Our Neighbors by Dr. Emily Smith, published by Zondervan and read by the author.
In solidarity. To Paul for teaching me the phrase, to Henry for anchoring it, to Edna for empowering it, to my children for embodying it, and to my husband for living it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Christianity. Health is the greatest of gifts. Buddhism. Perform all work carefully, guided by compassion. Hinduism. Whoever saves the life of a person is as if he has saved the life of the whole of humankind. Islam. Whoever saves a life, it is considered as if he saved an entire world. Judaism. And love your neighbor. That's just being a good human. My kid, age 9. Author's note. I am a straight, white, Christian cis woman with pronouns she, her, and hers from the United States of America who graduated from and works in universities in high-income settings. Those descriptors have granted me privileges and advantages, and it's important for me to acknowledge my own social location as we begin this book. I acknowledge that the land I live on and work in today is the traditional and ancestral homelands of the Eno, Shikori, Sisapaha, Okanichi, and their descendants, the Okanichi Band of the Sapani Nation. Although they lived in separate villages and developed distinct identities, they spoke a common Totelo-Sapani language. In this language, their descendants call them Yesaw, which means the people. I also acknowledge that a group in New Mexico, the traditional lands of the Tiwa Indians, the Pueblo, Apache, and Navajo nations, and I honor with gratitude the land itself and the first communities that lived there. Although I have worked hard to decolonize my work and heart, it is a work in progress. Introduction. I'm beginning this introduction as I sit at my kitchen table, the plain and with an E kitchen farm table I bought used and then refinished over a few weeks, with freshly picked flowers from my garden in a vase next to me. My table has scratches on it from when my son learned to write his alphabet with his granddad's, my dad's help, pushing through the paper a little too hard with his fingers as he tried to figure out how to hold his pencil. I love those scratches. My table isn't fancy or Instagrammable, but it's mine and it has held conversations, dreams, hearts, and tears. It's also where acquaintances become neighbors, and this is where I'm starting this introduction over again. I've written it twice before, and now here I am with the blinking cursor and a blank page. Aren't you supposed to start a book with a story of triumph or trauma? With something that makes the reader want more? Since I've never written a book before, I don't know, but I thought that's what you were supposed to do. So I wrote an introduction with trauma and drama. Then I wrote one with triumph and restoration. And then I made each a chapter tucked in between the other stories of triumph and trauma and real life. And I started over again. Because how would I start a conversation if you were sitting here with me at my table? Certainly not with triumph or trauma. I'd probably start by serving you coffee in one of my mismatched cups and telling you about this book. Despite its title, it's not a science book, so I promise not to bore you with, for instance, the Krebs cycle. Besides, I promptly forgot all about it approximately 0.4 seconds after taking the MCAT required for medical school, although I ended up getting a PhD instead, which I'll tell you about later in the book. And it's not really a faith book either, so I promise not to give you the meaning of Hebrew words from the book of Leviticus. It's also not necessarily about how to love our neighbors practically. Sure, you'll find a little bit of that, but some incredible books are already out there helping us do that. This book will show you that truly being a neighbor goes way beyond simply donating food or money. It's the and also way of neighboring. You'll notice the phrase and also a lot in this book, along with my love for nachos, Beyoncé, and Anna Green Gables. It's about doing the good things, like donating food or money, and also changing our hearts and posture to match those deeds. It's about shifting our perspectives away from just being good enough to living into a life of neighboring that comes as naturally to us as thirst. Not as a to-do list, but just being who we are. It's a radical shift in our thinking and worldview that will transform us into being different people. This brings me to Jesus' parable of the Good Samaritan, found in Luke 10, 25 through 37. And because I believe that story's three themes, centering, cost, and courage, have taught me this life of neighboring, that's how I've organized the book. Part one, centering, is mainly about changing our mindsets to think like a neighbor. We do this by challenging our current worldview or refocusing our attention, and then centering our hearts and minds on what Jesus centered on. Part two, cost, follows centering, because it will cost us something to center on our neighbors. Think of this as the in-between time, the time between when we center our actions, attention, and heart correctly, and then need courage to fully live out that change. This brings me to part three, courage. This final section is about how we can live as neighbors in word and deed. It will take bravery to do so, but the result is being who I think we were always meant to be, neighbors. I truly believe that the better we center on the right things, the more courage we'll have to be neighbors, despite the cost. As I mentioned, this isn't just a faith book anymore, then it's just a science book. But I've written it from my perspective as a Christian, as well as an epidemiologist. For those of you from another faith tradition or not of one at all, I sincerely hope you won't feel like I'm preachy or trying to convert anybody. Neither of these is my intent. I also don't want to position the Christian faith as the best or only faith. My personal faith has been my starting point, but it doesn't have to be everyone's. I hope you'll see that's the case through the stories of several friends of different faith traditions, or none at all. As the quotes in the front of this book reveal, loving our neighbors is universal among the faith traditions. It's just being a good human, as my kid says. Last, this isn't a book about traveling across an ocean to a different country. In fact, you don't have to go anywhere. Although I can't remember who said it first, I heard this saying at my work. Local is global, and global is local. To me, that means we're all connected. We saw that in bright, bold colors during the COVID-19 pandemic, didn't we? When a virus swept the globe across every continent. This phrase also means you can go all over the world or go nowhere at all to be a neighbor. I guess I'm trying to say that being a neighbor can be done anywhere by anyone. Some of you are bright-eyed students with dreams of traveling to distant countries for your career. Others of you are reading this book at 3 a.m., tending to a sweet baby who won't sleep for more than 3.5 minutes. To each of you, I say, solidarity. And that each of you is a neighbor by simply being one to people around the world or to your own children, elderly parents, or friends. Being a neighbor happens where we are and with the people around us. We've all lived through these few years of a deadly and scary pandemic and everything that has meant to our individual lives. So here at the beginning, dear reader, I'm thinking of you about how we each have a story full of the trauma we've collectively experienced and likely some triumph too. But now we're questioning what's next. I think the answer lies in a life of neighboring around a table like the one in my kitchen, but also around another table, a much bigger one. We'll get to that one by the end of the book, I promise. But first, pull up a chair and let me get you a cup of coffee. I'm so glad you're here, Emily. Part one, centering. Chapter one, two questions asked. Who is my neighbor, an expert in the law? Who was the neighbor, Jesus. I know the title of this book has the word science in it, and we'll get there, I promise, but I need to start with musical instruments, specifically the cello. You see, I've always loved art and music. I played the piano, still do at times, and I was also part of the percussion section in my high school band, mainly playing the marimba and sometimes the cymbals when I was feeling spicy. But I've always loved the sound of a cello and how a person can sway back and forth while playing the notes that seem inside them and need to come out. So as a pre-med student at Wayland Baptist University in the panhandle of Texas, I decided to become a cellist. Well, kind of. Cellos were expensive to rent, so I figured I would start with a cheaper string instrument and rented a violin. I took lessons from a great teacher in the university's music department and had great ambitions of becoming one of those women playing in an orchestra wearing a flowy dress. I think to help inspire me, or maybe to persuade me, to switch to a cello because she was also hearing me try to play the horrid hot cross buns weekly and failing miserably, my teacher gave me a CD recording by one of the best cellists in the world, Yo-Yo Ma. I never heard of him, but I played that CD on repeat at full blast in my dorm room for weeks. Fast forward with me. Still in college, I was spending a summer in Saratoga Springs in upstate New York to work as an assistant at a camp for high school kids through Johns Hopkins University. One weekend, we went to the outdoor symphony concert where you brought your own blanket and dinner and picked a spot to sit on a giant grassy knoll. The symphony played several compositions over an hour or so, and the evening ended with a standing ovation and whistling from the crowd. Then the magic happened, and I need to paint you a scene in your mind for the fairy dust to land on you too. The entire symphony left, and after packing up their dinner and blankets, just about everyone on the grass had left too. I'm not sure why I stayed, but it was probably because it was a gorgeous summer evening with dusk just settling in, and I didn't want to miss the moment and how beautiful it all felt. A friend sat beside me. Then, without any fanfare or introduction, a man walked onto the stage with a cello and started to play the prelude to the cello suite number 1 in G major by Bach. It was like someone froze all of us with fairy dust, because for the next few minutes, no one, especially me, moved. We were all enamored by the beautiful music. The musician played effortlessly, masterfully, emotionally, perfectly. Then, as silently as he appeared on stage, he walked off to thunderous applause from those of us still there. I looked at my friend with tears in my eyes and asked, "Who was that?" Her response, "Yo-Yo Ma." I had found myself at a free concert with the greatest cellist in the world. That night was magical, and I learned there's a difference between wanting to be a cellist and being one. A difference between being proficient enough to say, "I played the cello," and mastering the instrument. I was so struck by Yo-Yo Ma's effortless playing, which seemed entirely natural to him, like he was doing exactly what he was made to do, creating life with the cello's strings. I wanted to be a cellist, but I was practicing minimally, only enough to show the practice log to the teacher. I was living, how much is good enough to be a cellist, while Yo-Yo Ma was living, being one. And he'd been living it for years. Wholly, fully, naturally in a way that he could jump onto a stage and play without any sheet music because the notes were in him, completely captivating whoever was listening. When people ask who's the finest cellist around today, many answer with his name. I start with this experience because I think it illustrates the central point of this book. Lots of us are familiar with Jesus' Good Samaritan story in the 10th chapter of Luke. It's about an injured man who needed help on the side of the road and how two people merely walked by him before a Samaritan man finally stopped to help. Tucked around this story like two pieces of bread around a cheese and turkey sandwich are two questions whose distinctions we can miss at first glance. They seem the same on the surface, but they're different in how they were asked and who asked them. first an expert in rabbinical law who had just asked Jesus how to live forever and was told to love his neighbor, said, "Who is my neighbor?" That's the first question. And Jesus responded with the Good Samaritan story before even asking the second question.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.